Is it still lagging or not? Okay, so maybe we will get a confirmation from the YouTube site as well. I'm seeing that someone from Twitch said that it's working. I'm moving. Yeah, I am. So maybe someone from YouTube can confirm that on that side is working as well. That is disabled. Oh, thanks. I will check now to see. Maybe it did link to a different event. Okay, so let's see if it's enabled now. I'm not sure why, but sometimes it's reverting back to the default settings and it's disabling the chat messages on YouTube. So please, if you are on YouTube, please let me know in the chat if the stream is working properly. You should be allowed to post messages now. I will post the entire video on the YouTube, so you will be able to see everything that you missed so far. So we are continuing the demo. We started, if you can properly see now the screen, I will switch to the IDE now. Please let me know if you are able to see the IDE now. So what we did here, we created an empty activity and we added two callbacks on create and on pause. And we are trying to see how the application is reacting and it's notifying us that those activities, the activity is in a certain state. So let's add the third one. We saw that we have on restart as well. And here we will add again the same type of a message, but this time with on restart, and we will redeploy the activity. And now if we are rotating, let's say, the device, we can see that we have on pause that was called, and if we are rotating back, we should see on pause again. In order to see on restart and on create, we need to somehow trigger the application to be restarted for us. And that can be done if we are opening something else, let's say another activity. So here we can see that we received on pause. And if we are switching to our activity, we can see that we got the on restart callback as well. So I hope that you are able to see that we received on restart as well here. Okay, and please try to implement similarly all the other callbacks and try them on your own to see how the application will react for you. And especially, please try the on stop see if it will be cold. Like I said, most of the time we will not see on stop and on destroy, and that's why our main destroy logic, or the callback that will be mostly used, will be the on pause to persist the user details. Okay. Now we are switching a little bit the topic, and we are discussing about layouts. So what are the available options for us to build our UI site? The first variations that the Android team provided, it's a declarative UI where all the components are either views or view groups, and the view group is also a view. Okay, a group is, like we can see on the screen, is able to maintain other views or other groups in it. But at the end of the day, it's a view as well. To define a UI, we have multiple options today, but at the beginning we had only an XML variation, so we were able to define the layout of our components in an XML, and the file is named layout because it's describing how the components will be presented on the screen. And here, as we can see, we have a text which is saying hello, I'm a text view, and the button that is advertising that's a button. And we are using a linear layout. Probably if you worked with any UI frameworks, you already understand what a linear layout is a way on specifying that our components should be presented one next to each other, and by default it's on a vertical direction. Okay, we can easily flip the direction using the orientation field, and we can see here that it's set to vertical. We can change the value to be horizontal, and then they will be presented on the same row, if you like. What's important here is that in our class, in our activity, we need to specify and to link the code, the activity code, with the layout, and that's done in the onCreate callback using the setContentView call. And here we are providing the name of the layout file. In this case, it's named main layout. And like we mentioned in the first lecture, everything that's part as from in the resource folder will be available on the Java side or on the Kotlin side using the R object. And then the name of the directory, so r.layout.mainlayout, will link our application with the main layout file. It's important to be aware that here we are using the snake notation, so main underscore layout. What's important for us as developers, and it's optional in the XML file, are the ID fields. And here, using @ and then the name of the directory slash the name of the resource will allow us to bind the component which for which we are providing the ID with an identifier in the resource object. The +, here means that if the resource identifier is not already available, it will be automatically created for us. Okay, so we have two identifiers. Here we can see how, using the identifier for the button, we can use the find view by ID call, which is available in all activities and fragments, to be able to link an resource from the XML side, an asset, to the corresponding object on the class side, on the object side. And here you can see how we are declaring a button. So we are specifying that a value named my button of type button. And as an actual initialization, we are using the find view by ID. There are a lot of ways on linking an asset to an object on the Kotlin side. This is the first one that was provided for us. And you'll see that there are now better ways to link IDs to objects. Let's see if we have some comments here. So Razvan is saying that it's working properly now, so that's good to know. And Andreas is asking if we can have a short summary of what we did. Unfortunately not, so you will be able to. I already did a small summary, so we will be able to see the full stream afterwards. So like I said, here the important thing is to use the same notation in the XML and also in the Java side. R.id.button will be the identifier that will link the my button variable with the actual button from the XML side. Once we have those two linked, we will be able to interact in code with them. We can either specify in the XML the callback handler. So here you can see that we added the onClick XML field equal to send message, and that will allow us to use a function named send message that will perform the actual work when the button will be pressed. Okay, so that's one variation. And here, obviously, we need the same name to be used in both of the sides. You'll see that the IDE, Android Studio, will flag us with a warning and an error if the name is not found in the class side. Another variation that I'm recommending you to use, instead of relying on Find View by ID, is to use a package named Android KTX Kotlin extensions. And if we are using that extension, and we will see in a demo how we can register the Kotlin extension plugin in our application, we will be able to use something that's named a synthetic import. So that import Kotlin X Android.synthetic.main and then the name of the layout dot star will allow us to get rid of find view by ID. So we will no longer need to search for the field ourselves. Also, we will be able to define the callbacks on demand, if you like. So instead of using a function, we will use a lambda here, and we will use directly the name of the field from the layout. So in the layout, we had an ID named button for the actual button component. And if we are using the synthetic import, that name will be automatically made available for us in the function, in the onCreate function, in the whole activity. Okay, and after that we can use all the fields that are available for that button component. And we are using here the set on click listener, and using a lambda, we are defining a behavior. We have a demo here as well. It's, I think, the, oh, sorry, not this one. This IDE. So if we are switching to my application, I think it's named here. Yeah, so it's this one. Let's deploy it, and while is deploying here, we can see that we did the same thing here with set content view. We established the activity main layout. So here we have the ID, we have a text view with ID text, so that one that is present here. At the beginning, it's saying, hello, I'm a text view, like we had before. Then we have an edit text with the ID edit text, and our button with the name button. And in our activity, we are using the button component here directly. We don't have any find view by ID. If we are performing a control click on the button, you'll see that we are jumping directly to the button component. So this is available because we use the synthetic import, and here we defined the set on click listener with our lambda, and we can see that we are accessing the text component, the one that is the first one on the screen, and as a value we are retrieving something from the second component, which is named edit text. Here you can see that we have a warning. We will discuss more about it at laboratories. The idea is that Android Studio is encouraging us to build applications that are available in multiple languages and to reuse resources. A text like this is a resource that can be made available in other languages, and for this we should use a string resource. Right now, for demo purposes, to not introduce them yet, we are only concatenating some strings here. So from edit text we will add the value, and we will change also the label on the button to say updated. Okay, update, not updated. And if we are adding some text here and then we are pressing the button, you'll see that our text from here is changed, our label. So if we are saying, let's say, test 1, 2, 3, we will see that we updated the text view. Okay, so this is an easy way to get access to our UI components. Okay, so with set content view we are establishing the layout, and then using the synthetic import we will be able to access individual components directly by their ID name. Like I said, for this to work in our Gradle, we will need to register a plugin. So you'll see that automatically we are getting two plugins. Like if we are using Kotlin, we will get automatically those two plugins. So Android application and Kotlin Android. And if we would like to use the KTX extensions, so the Android the synthetic import, we need to register this plugin as well. To review a little bit also the structure of the Gradle files, we have one big Gradle project level file where we are usually presenting what are the overall dependencies. So here we are dependent on Gradle, Gradle being the tool that is used for building our app, and we have a plugin for that as well. And then we are specifying the repositories from which Gradle will retrieve the dependencies. And then we have one dependency per module. In our application right now we have only one module named app, and in this application, because it's a mobile application, we have the Android section where we are specifying what's the SDK, what's the target SDK, what's the minimum SDK, the application ID, which is the package name recommended to be used, and the version. We will discuss about those and the rest of the IDs in a later lecture in more details. Then we have a section where we are specifying how a flavor of our build should be done, and here we by default we are getting a release target where we are applying some rules to obfuscate our code. We will discuss more about them later. What's important right now is that we have a dependency section where we will list what are our dependencies. Okay, if we are using Kotlin, we will get this dependency, the standard lib dependency, automatically. And if our layout is using constraint layout, we will discuss in a minute more about constraint layout. So it's similar to vertical layout that we saw, the linear layout that we saw previously. but it's adding more capability. So it's something more complex. The latest iteration on layouts that's available on Android, named Constraint Layout, it's part of a library, so it can be used let's say, older SDKs as well. It's decoupled from the SDK. And then we have some dependencies on tests. We will have a separate lecture dedicated to test our applications, and there we will discuss about all of those dependencies. Okay, so to conclude, we have two configuration, Gradle file configurations, one per project and one per module. And here in the settings Gradle, we are specifying which module is included in the project. Okay, so please try at home and use the synthetic import to be able to link components to our UI. Here in the layout folder, right now we have only one layout, and like we said, we are using the linear layout. But we will see in a minute how we can use other layouts as well. Let's get back to our slides. So like we said, here we can use the synthetic import, and we can have access directly to the fields. Another important thing when we are discussing about screens is what form factors are we supporting? And as you already know, there are a lot of devices that are able to run Android applications, from TVs to wearables like watches, and the majority of them being tablet size devices or phone devices. And we would like to build our layouts as flexible as we can to use, a way to construct them to adapt as easily as possible for us as developers to as more form factors as we can. You'll see that there are times when or for some specific resources, we will need to prepare specific resources for those devices. So if we are considering only images, let's say, when we are presenting a background image or a resource for, an icon image for, a profile picture or resources that are available for a font size, let's say. If we will deploy the same application with the same resources to a tablet or to a TV running the same application, those resources will be stretched and will look badly on those devices. It will look as they are not properly created for those devices. And to address this issue, the Android framework is providing us a way to specify alternate layouts and alternate resources for specific form factors. Another way on filling the gaps, let's say, when we are stretching an application, is to define stretchable images. We will see we can use SVG, so vector images, that will automatically adapt to the ratio of the screen size, and they will fill properly the screen. Also, we can provide bitmaps with different sizes for all our screens. And everything is doable, but the recommended way, like I said, is to use vector graphics if possible, because those will take the less amount of space and will look best on all form factors. And if you like to see more details about each of the ones presented above, you can check the link present on the bottom of the screen. But right now we will discuss about constraint layout. And like you said, constraint layout is the most advanced layout that's available right now on Android. And I can say that it's something that's not available yet on other platforms. So I didn't saw yet a layout similar to the constraint layout for the desktop side or for iOS as well. So here on the picture, the capture that we have on the slide, we can see that we can specify constraints relative to other widgets. So we can say that that phone icon should be linked to the left button. That arrow is specifying that it's linked to the left button, and it has a 16 margin required. Then we have those two labels, the phone and the Google Voice tag, that are linked to the phone icon on the right side of the phone icon. So you can see that we can link the orientation and also the spacing of the widgets one next to another, and also in regards to the parent component. The part that's lower on the left side is presenting the blueprint, so the schematics of our widgets. And that's exposed also on the Android, on the IDE side, sorry, in Android Studio. So if we are switching to another project here, I think we have one that's named Flexible Layout. And here, let's check in the layout. Yeah, we have, I think, two here. We are combining two demos here to show also the availability of specifying a different layout for a different orientation in the landscape side. So this one, if we will switch to the package side and view, sorry, and if we are checking the resource folder in the layout, you can see here that we have another directory named layout land from landscape, and here we have one file named activity main, and in the landscape variation we have the same file. If we are switching back to Android view, we can see that it's combining them and it's adding a tag here that's differentiating them. So that's a layout that will be used in the normal mode, and this one will be automatically used for us in the landscape mode. So this is how we can adapt, if you like, to different screen orientation and also to different screen sizes by providing a layout for a different screen size. We are taking a 10 minutes break. And after the break, we will discuss more about the constraint layout. Okay, so we are back. So like I said, here we will demo how we can use constraint layout. And in this layout, we can see that we are using constraint layout. If we are switching to the design view, so in by default, we are seeing the code view here, and we see the XML file presented. If we are switching here to on the upper left, corner, we have the design view, and here we can see how the components are presented on the screen, and you can change the device type here to see how the layout would look like on a different type of a phone, let's say, or on a tablet, how it will adapt. Let's stick to a phone right now. And on the right side, we can see the blueprint. And if we are selecting a component, we are seeing the constraints as well. So we have here some margins that we added. And for that text label, we added an anchor to the top and one to the right and one to the left. And we can tailor here what's the amount of margin that we would like to see. Everything that is presented here as number is specified in a unit named DP, which stands for density pixels. It's not in pixels, it's in density pixels. And why it's important to use DP instead of pixels or any other unit measure like centimeters or feet or something else, is because from one device to another, the resolution of the screen will be different. Okay, so if we are saying here 8 pixels on this device, a Pixel 3a, maybe it will look like it is presented now on the screen. But if we will switch automatically to a tablet, that 8 pixel will be much smaller than will appear as a smaller distance here than on the pixel device, because we now suddenly we have a lot more pixels on the horizontal axis. Okay, with 8 dp independent pixels, we can guarantee that the same amount of space here will be used from one device to another. So if you like, it's behaving like percentages in a responsive design on the website. Okay, so please use DP instead of centimeters or pixels or any other unit. Also for fonts, here you can see that it's pretty small right now, the label that we are using. We have a variation for the size as well to be independent of the screen ratio. And here, I think in the text size, if we are selecting text size as an attribute, we can set it to 14 dp, but that's not recommended to be used for text. For text, we will use sp. So from settable or scale independent pixels, because in our settings, we can change automatically the preference of the font size. And by using SP instead of DP there, we will allow the system to control the size of the font that we are using automatically to adapt it to our users' needs. Okay, so by using constraint layout, you will be able to create a flexible view for your users that will adapt to all sorts of screen ratios and sizes. Okay, so please use constraint layout. And like I said, in this demo, we will present also how we can use a different resource for a different screen orientation. And here we have the landscape one. If we will check our activity, you'll see that here we don't have any logic that will say to switch the layout from one file to another. We are only setting the content view to be the activity main. And by default, the operating system will detect if we have a landscape layout to use that one. If we are comparing the two from here, we can compare files. You'll see that we don't have a lot of differences here. We added the size here just a minute ago. And on the landscape side, we have a different background color, okay? Other than that, the files are the same. So we are changing the background color only to highlight that we changed the orientation and we are using a different orientation file, okay? So if we are deploying this application on the device, we have a similar app here that will take an input and present it on the screen. But if we are changing the orientation, and my device here needs a confirmation on the change, you'll see that we change the background here to be red, okay? And I think in the layout file we mentioned here a different color, but I think we used a different value. Let's see. So for background, where we set the background layout, this is the landscape one. Oh, the color was white, sorry, for the text was white, but the background for the layout is red. So we are using here a background color. That's what was also different and we missed. So here in the layout file, we are specifying also a background color for the whole layout, okay? So that's was different. On the landscape side, we are using color accent red, okay? And if we are switching to our application, you'll see that now suddenly we are using a different layout. In those layouts, like we saw, we have the same content, but theoretically we can have a totally different content when on landscape versus the normal mode, okay? So it's not mandatory to have the same content. We can have a totally different content for those orientations. And we will see in a later demo that we are doing that in different orientations. Any questions till now? We saw in the demo how we can use a different layout for landscape. Similarly, we can use a different layout for a totally different device. So here we can see how we can specify an activity layout different for a 7-inch tablet in normal mode and in landscape mode. Because we have a different screen density here, much more than on a phone, we can pack more components and we can arrange them differently. So sometimes it's making sense to have a different layout. And here for a 7-inch tablet, we can see that the name of directory has that SV600DP name. And you can look up all of those in the link that I presented below, and we already saw a demo for this. To build a dynamic UI, sometimes it's not only making sense to rearrange the same components in different ways. Sometimes we need to have different content from one orientation to another, or from one device to another, because like we said, they can display more, or for some, it's not making sense to pack as many information as on other device. And for this, somewhere in the beginning of the Android framework, they recognize the need of reusing activities, and they name them fragments. So a fragment is similar to an activity, but it's tailored or simplified a little bit to be reused in another activity. And here we can see that on the tablet side, we have two screens from the mobile handset side combined. So we have a list. If you like, here we can imagine an email client where on the left side we have the list of emails, and once we select an email, we are seeing the content of that email on the left side of the screen. On the handset side, we have the list on the full screen, and once we select something, we will switch the activity to the content of that email. Okay, and for this, using fragments, we can reuse those components, and we can combine them and instantiate them when it's making sense. So if the device is in landscape mode, maybe we are presenting both of them. If it's in normal mode, we are presenting fragment A, and then when performing an action on fragment A, we are switching to fragment B. Okay, so you can learn more about fragments. You'll see that we will study some frameworks later in our lectures that will replace the fragment need, but we need to understand them as well, because there are a lot of existing applications that are still using fragments, and they will still be used probably in the next years once the new libraries will catch will be mature enough to be used by everybody. In terms of life cycle of a fragment, we have almost the same callbacks as for an activity. Like I said, a fragment was derived from an activity, and they added more callbacks like on attach, on create view, on activity created, and on destroy view, and on detach. Those are all the new callbacks that were received by the fragment. On attach is used when the fragment is attached to an activity. Like I mentioned, a fragment can be reused in different activities. So it's making sense to have a callback that will notify it that is attached to another activity. On create view is used to, like the on create of the main activity, to be able to restore the fragment content. On activity created is a callback that will signal us that the activity that the fragment is inserted upon was recreated. So when we are sharing the same content among activities, some of the activities that is holding the fragment may be recreated, and then we will get the notification. On destroy view is the corresponding destroy method for on create view. So here we will destroy the view of the fragment. And on detach is the corresponding callback for on attach. So when the fragment is detached from an activity. Okay, so the life cycle here is a little bit more linear, and it's reusing most of the callbacks from the activity, plus the new callbacks that we just discussed. To create a fragment, we can either create it programmatically or using XML. Here we can see how on create we can inflate. So something similar to the way on how we were specifying a layout for an activity. Here we are using the inflator object to specify a layout for the fragment. And here we are using the same construct, resource.layout, example fragment is the layout that will be used here in this fragment. The container here is the view group, so is the view component that will hold the new fragment. And the third argument that falls there, if it's true, it means that the new fragment will have the container as the embedding component, and if it's false, it means that it's detached from the XML layout and can survive on its own as well, so it can be reused in other components. In the XML layout, we have a separate XML field named tag, sorry, named fragment, and here we are specifying with the name the actual class file that is holding the new fragment. We have an ID that will be used to bind the fragment or to link the fragment to an actual fragment object, and then we have ways to control its dimension or how to be layout on the screen. What's interesting here is that we are using layout weight, which is a flex box like construct, so we can use some weights in order to control how much of the real estate of the screen will be used by this fragment. And here we can see that in total we are using we are dividing the screen in three, so that weight equal to one will be 1/3 of the screen allocated to article list fragment, and 2/3 of the screen with weight equal to 2 will be allocated for the reader fragment in this case. Okay, so like I said, another way is to use it programmatically, and whenever we are switching to a fragment or when we are creating a fragment, we need to use a transaction because we need to ensure that the screen is always consistent. Okay, so when we something bad is happening, we need to restore to a proper screen layout. And to be able to begin a transaction, to start a transaction, we will use a fragment manager. That support fragment manager is a variable that's available in all activities. And then from that fragment manager, we can call begin transaction to start an actual transaction. After that, we will use the add or replace method, so fragment transaction.add or fragment transaction.replace with the ID of the fragment, and then we will specify our actual class that is defining the fragment. And after that, we will commit the changes. That will ensure that our screen will transition to and properly initialize the fragment. And we have a demo here as well. If we are switching to Android Studio, the project is named something with fragments, this window, and we are terminating the previous app. So here what we have in our code is one main activity in which we are programmatically switching to the screen to two fragments. And here we are using the layout to see if both of the fragments can be displayed on the screen. So we are using find view by ID here, and we are querying to see if the container fragment is available. Then we will replace the content with the article list fragment, and if also the detailed container fragment is available, we will use the article reader fragment. If one of them is not available, only one will be present on the screen. And if we are checking the resources in the layout here, in the main activity, you'll see that we have two variations of the layout. In the normal mode, and if we are switching to code here, you'll see that we have only one fragment listed, the container one. And in the landscape mode, on the code side, we have both of them available. So when the application will run in the normal mode, we will have only one fragment presented on the screen. And if in landscape, we will attach and use both of them. And here you can see that we again use that flex layout weights to specify the screen area that will be used. And if we are deploying here, in the normal mode, we have a list of elements. It's not truly a list. We are presenting them here in a list-like manner, but it's not actually a list. We will discuss what does a list do differently. And we have a text and some buttons. And if we are pressing on either of the buttons, we can see that we have a message here that is saying change the orientation first. Okay, so it's notifying us that that behavior is available only in the landscape mode. And if we are changing to the landscape mode, we can see that we have a different layout because we changed the background here. And if we are pressing a button now, we have some details for that button. They are not very impressive because we are only listing 5 times the name of the button and that the button was pressed. Okay? And we can switch for any of them. And this was achieved in the main activity, like I said, by binding to an available container a different fragment. And if we are looking here for the article fragment, we can see that we are no longer extending the activity class like we did for our main activity. So here we extended frame activity to have access to the manager, to the support manager. Now in the fragments, we are extending fragment. We are using a construct here named companion object, which is the corresponding, if you like, singleton construct for, or we are constructing a new instance that will be a singleton for this class. And the companion object is the corresponding static fields from the Java side. Okay, and here we are defining a listener, an interface. This is how we can exchange information between the activity and the frame, the fragment. In the fragment, we are defining an interface. That interface will be implemented here. So we are extending that article fragment on list on selection listener in the activity, and we are implementing it in the activity. So here the on select details will be triggered, and here will be the place where we can exchange information between the activity and the fragment. And here you can see how we get access to the fragment using our instance, singleton instance. And then to push information from activity to the fragment, we will use an object named bundle, where we can push all sorts of fields. It's a key value pair, so we can push bytes or characters or floats or integers, all sorts of information by using a key and then a value. We are setting that bundle as arguments for the fragment, and when we are transitioning with a transaction to the fragment, we are specifying in the fragment that those arguments. Okay, here we can see that construct, that toast message that was saying to change the orientation first. So if the container was not available, then we were presenting a toast, which is a UI component that will be presented on the screen. We can specify a time length for it, how much time that component should be available on the screen. Okay, and this is how we are sending information from the activity to the fragment. And if we are switching to the details fragment here, we can see how similarly we have the instance created. On onCreate, we are inflating another layout here, the fragment one. And here what we are doing, we are extracting from that bundle, we are getting back the messages in order to get our information here. Button 2 in this case was pressed. okay, and for 5 times from 0 to 4 we are creating text views that we are appending to the linear layout. So here we are using a linear layout with a vertical orientation, the default one, that will present 5 times the message. Okay, so this is how we can create fragments and display them dynamically on the screen. Okay. Another class of components that we will need to use in our applications, and you'll see that for our exams, we will take into account seriously if we properly handled and display progress indicators. And usually they are used to give the user a feedback on their actions. So a progress bar or a circular progress indicator is a simple way to provide the user feedback that some actions are happening behind the scenes and our UI is not stuck, let's say. Okay, so you'll see that there are a lot of them. I mentioned here a couple of them, like rating bar or sig bar. You can check them all. To declare them an XML, we will use something like this. So we will specify progress bar, then an ID. Here we can see some new constructs like layout width and layout height that are allowing us to specify the dimensions of our components. And like I said, most of the time we will use DP, but we have some special constructs like wrap content or match parent. Those wrap content means that the dimensions of our component should be the minimum one that needs to present properly the component. And match parent will say that we should use all the available space that the parent is providing. Okay? And we will use combinations of wrap content, DPs, and match parent in order to create a layout that will make sense for our components. Another field that we are using here, especially with progress indicator, will be the visibility one. So by default, we will say as a value gone, meaning that we would not like to render that component by default on the screen. And only programmatically, we will switch the visibility from visible to gone. So when we would like to start the callback, the backend callback, let's say, we will change the visibility of our progress to visible, to show it on the screen. And once we are done, the action is finished, we will switch it back to gone. And the previous component that was covered by the progress indicator will be suddenly visible. Okay? So we will demo the progress indicators together with another component. Like we said, the topic of our lecture is lists. And here we are discussing about a component that allows us to easily present information in a list. This is a requirement for the CRUD applications as well, to present the domain objects in a list. This component is pretty popular. It's now replaced by a more efficient one, but as key principles, we have the same way on working with it. And it allows us basically to present a list of items. The newer one that is recommended to be used is the recycle view, and we will see in a minute what's the difference between the two. So, as a list view to render on the screen, like I said, a list of elements, we will use the XML tag named list view, and then we need another layout file that will specify how each item from the list will be rendered. And here you can see that we are, for each element, we are rendering it using two text fields. One is the text and another one is the subtext. And we are combining both of them in the Java, in the code side, in Kotlin right now. by using the my list construct. So we have a field corresponding for our list view named my list using the syntactic import that will be available in our code. And here you can see how we are using an adapter to specify the layout for the items. So we are using the array adapter, which is built in the system. We are specifying for it the context, which will be the fragment or the activity, and then the layout for each item named simple list item 1, which is also defined by the system, so it's not part of our resources. That's why it's starting with android.r. And then we are specifying the array of elements. And once we have the adapter, we are only setting it to our list view by using listview.adapter equal to our own adapter. Okay? So, like I said, that my list using the syntactic import will make that available. If we are switching to our project here that we prepared for as this demo, you can see that we, as an array list, we are using an mutable list of 100 elements. And here you can see how using the map operator on a range, we can construct a list. And the list will be, so each integer will be mapped to a string named item and then the integer, and that will be constructed as a list. We presented on the slides how we are creating the adapter, and here we are setting the adapter. On click here, we are doing something more, and we are introducing an animation here as well. We are starting a progress indicator, and then we are deleting the actual item from the list. So we are removing it from the actual array list. And each time we are removing something from the original list, we will need to notify the adapter. This is something very important that we will check as well in our laboratory. So please pay attention. If you are removing something from the database, from the server side, and that content was exposed in a list or in a recycle view, we need to notify the adapter as well. For this animation, we are also changing the alpha channel for the animation. And once the animation is done, we are hiding the progress indicator as well. So if we are starting the demo here and changing the orientation back, we have our list view of 100 elements here. And as you can see, by default, we can scroll here. And if we are performing a click, we are starting a progress indicator, and then we are removing the element. So you can see that it's fading out when we are performing a click, and it's removed. So that's done by this animation, the fade out using the alpha channel. We are specifying that we would like 1 second for the animation to run. And once the animation is done, we are removing the element from the screen. So that's why it's fading first, and after that it's removed once the visibility is gone. Okay, so this is how we can use a progress indicator and also a list. And if we are checking our layout here, you'll see that we have a simple list view and a progress bar, which by default was gone. So both of them are present in the layout, but the progress bar is hidden by default. Okay. And in the list view, we are initializing it with that list of elements. Okay. Like I said, a list view is not recommended anymore to be used. We should use a recycle view because the list view is maintaining all the elements in memory. And if we have thousands or million of elements, all of them will be held in memory, and our activity will have a tough time presenting all of them. And that's why it's recommended now to use a recycle view that will allocate memory only for the elements that are visible on the screen, and a couple of them to be used at the bottom and to below, to be able to quickly render everything that should be rendered on the screen when the user is swiping up or down. Okay. In order to create a recycle view, we will use recycle view instead of list view, and we are using the same constructs here. So we have an adapter. A recycle view has, it's a newer component, has also a manager associated with it that will allow us to switch from one view that is the list view by default to a card view as well. So in the layout file, by using the ID, we will be able to find ID, or if we are using a synthetic import, that recycle view will be available for us. The adapter can be a custom one, so we can either use, like we saw, an array adapter, a simple one, or we can use a custom one. And here we can see how we can define a custom one, a recycle view adapter custom that is extending the recycle view adapter class. And for the objects, we are defining a holder, and for the holder we need to implement two methods: on create view, a callback that will be used to create a new entry on the screen, and on bind view, whenever we are reusing an item to populate the new information in it. And a third method to get the count of the set. And here we have a demo as well. So if we are switching to our IDE in the recycle view, you'll see that we have almost the same logic here. This class was generated using the drawer template, so everything that we see here was generated for us, and you can use it also as a base for your UI native class. Okay, so here we have a list of elements, and please check the source code on your own to see how we are defining here also the adapter, and how the elements are populated in the adapter. Here, if we are performing a click on an element, we are switching the view to a detailed one where we can update the information. Right now, the update logic is not implemented, but on your CRUD project, you can easily use what's available here to as a base to add new elements using this button, let's say, and to update or delete from the list the elements. What's important here is that we are in the list fragment, I think, here. We are, or in the, sorry, in the list activity. Here we are setting up the recycle view, and we are using our adapter here defined. So as an adapter, we are specifying this class, and here, like we said, we have those three methods: the on create, on bind, and get items. So please take a look and learn how to create your own adapter. In order to retrieve data from a REST service, let's say, or from the internet, we have a couple of options. The earliest one that was available was named async task, which now from last year was deprecated, and this year they said that they will quickly remove it from the framework because we have better alternatives. And another one that we will present right now at this lecture was developed by the same guys that are developing now Kotlin, the Kotlin language, named Anko. But we need also to understand how async task is working, because there are a lot of projects that are still using it. So the async task has a bunch of methods. Some of them are running on the background thread. So the idea is that if you are trying to retrieve data from a database or from the internet directly from our activity, from our onCreate callback, let's say, Because those operations can take quite a few times, so a couple of seconds, will delay the interaction of the user with our activity, and it can delay it too much, and then the system will react and it will say the application is not responding on users' events, or it will give the user the sense that this application is very slow and is not working. Okay, and to cope with that, we should perform all the DB interactions and the server interactions in a background thread. And the async task is especially designed for this because it has a method specially designed to run tasks on the background. And once the information is retrieved on the background, we get callbacks that are running on the UI side, so we can present the information for the user. On pre-execute are the callback that will run before the doing background task is running, and post-execute and on progress update is running while the background task is running, and post-execute is running after the background task is done. So if you like, this is the flow that is happening. And as an alternative, we have an Anko library designed by the IntelliJ team, the one that created the Kotlin language as well. But we will see that now we have better constructs that are similar to Anko ones. Here, the do async task is executing everything on the background thread, and in that background thread, we have another lambda expression named UI thread that will run everything on the UI. Okay, so here we are performing a network call, and then with that result, we are presenting it on the screen. Okay. Okay, so this is what we had prepared for this lecture. Now we will check the async demo, and then please, if you have questions, let's discuss them. So here we have both of the samples in the same application. Now we are using the async task here first, so we have a button, and when the bat button is pressed, we are calling the async task. So here you can see that this class is extending the async class. The Anko async task is extending the Anko one. You can see here that we are checking if we have network available. That call should be something that you should check as well in your applications once you will implement the server implementation. So here we are using the network capability object to detect if we have Wi-Fi or cellular or Ethernet connection. Okay, and based on that we can specify if we have or not internet connections. In our async class on pre-execute, we are showing the progress indicator. In the background, we are using an activity reference, something that will prevent memory leaks, to call another class that will download an URL. And once the URL is downloaded, we will present the content on the screen and we will hide the progress indicator. On the Anko side, so here we are using the URL in the download to download the content from an URL. In the Anko implementation, you can see that we are doing almost the same thing to the one presented on the slides. In the background, we are downloading the content, and then on the UI lambda, we are presenting the content on the screen. And if we are running this app, you'll see that here we have a text field where we can enter an URL with HTTPS, let's say, google.com, and then we have a progress indicator, and then we have the raw output and only the first 500 bytes. And if we are switching to the Anko implementation, you'll see that we have changed a little bit the let's apply the changes. We change a little bit the response side So we are still having the same output, but now we are presenting an alert here. We are saying that the data was successful. This is a dialog that was implemented and presented here. So with this alert, it's a alert dialog that has that message, this title, and we have two lambdas that will capture the yes or no button. So here, if we are pressing OK, it will say yay here. If we are pressing cancel, it will present a sad response. Okay, so I hope that you had the chance to see how we can build some responsive UIs and how we can retrieve data from the server side. And like Horatio is mentioning, some of them are deprecated, and we will see in a later lecture how we will use the recommended way, which is Kotlin coroutines, to use constructs that are similar to the Anko ones that we just presented, that are more efficient and easier to use than the async task. So please, if you have questions, do let me know. If not, we will end the lecture here, and we will discuss more at the laboratories. So, any questions? I know that we have a 10 seconds delay, so I will wait a couple of seconds to see if we have some questions. Yes, Christian, everything that we presented on the lectures is available already on the GitHub repository. So if you will check the lecture page, you'll see that I have the first link in the resources section is the link to the GitHub repository, and there we have all the samples that we presented today in the second lecture. Here, if we are switching to our browser, in the lecture page, so /done/ma here, in the resource sections, here we have GitHub MA repository, and here in the lectures, for the second lecture, you'll see all the samples that we discussed today, and also we have some Flutter samples that we will discuss at the laboratory with some of you today, with the rest on the next week, okay? Okay, so it seems that we have some users that are spanning our content here. Okay. Yeah, they are. So they will not be available anymore. Okay. So if we don't have any other questions, I wish you health, and please have a great week. We will see us in the laboratories. Take care. Bye.